years. So yes, a big thank you to the Leamington Choral Society for being here this evening to get us started. And nice level too. That I can actually hit those notes. So well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Members of the council, are there any disclosures of pecuniary interest? I see none. No approval of council minutes? Wow. Business arising out of the minutes, there's none. So public meetings, there's none. We go right into reports of staff and delegations. So this evening we're starting off with the delegation, the Leamington Chamber of Commerce, presentation of final report for the community labor market and study recommendations. Yeah, you know.
Good evening, Mayor Patterson, members of council and staff. I'm Wendy Parsons, the general manager of the Leamington District Chamber of Commerce. And as you can see on slide number 2, we're here to present the agenda for our labor market review and study. And and that's okay. So on slide 3, as mentioned at an earlier council meeting, the Chamber wrote a grant application last winter, and we were approved by the Ministry of Training and Ministry of Training, Colleges and Universities. And we completed our process as planned. And on slide 4, you'll see the rest of the process that we went and finished that we'll be talking about tonight. On slide 5, tonight our study will help us project the future labor market needs in Leamington and the local area and identify and address any gaps between the skills in the existing workforce and those needed to support future business growth. We've included numerous community and business leaders in our process, and with the help of the steering committee, including myself, Dave Campbell, Janine Lasseline Berglund, Wayne Warm, and Dave Dick, and our other supporters, Stan Brophy and Sandy Bratt, we were able to make some recommendations going forward. At this time, I would like to introduce our labor market specialist, Denise Ganim, who has completed the report, and she is going to present our findings to council tonight.
Thank you very much, Wendy. So you know you are getting the sneak preview because we're not officially releasing the report to all of the participants and chamber members until tomorrow. Okay. So I think you'll recall part of our process, in addition to the qualitative focus groups and interviews we did, one of the things we undertook was what was called a Delphi survey, and this was to try to build some community consensus around what was the anticipated level of growth. And so the way a Delphi survey works, you ask for the initial input from all of the participants, and that was all of the folks that took part in our focus group process and were interviewed. We got a mean score and a standard deviation from that. And then we took that information, sent it back out to those participants, along with what would be considered some expert opinion. So those are folks like Bank of Canada, the federal government, the provincial government, most of the major banks in Canada. So the initial, you'll see, our anticipated business people in this community were anticipating 1.5% growth in GDP in a one-year term, but the standard deviation was 2.5%. So it's pretty widespread around. So, you know, some people were saying 10%, some people were saying negative 5. So it's a pretty widespread. The expert opinions, and again, this data was gathered at the end of 2015. Many of the experts have revised and downgraded their expectations for growth in 2016, beginning in the first quarter of this year. But the data that we had sent out to the group, 1.6%, three-year forecast 2.34%, and the five-year forecast 2%. So given that information, the participants basically had the opportunity to resubmit their growth expectations, and that is what the revised number is. So, and what you'll see, so 1.12% for 1 year, but the standard deviation has reduced down to less than 1%. 2% for the three-year period and 2.6% by the end of the five-year period. Those are the numbers that we then used in our forecasting model to predict what we think will be the growth in labor demand in our community. So, one of the challenges with trying to do economic forecasting at this level is we don't have GDP data at the community level. So what I took was a rolling five-year average of the GDP in for all of the province of Ontario and basically divided by the number of employed people in the province of Ontario to get what I'm going to call a value-added number per employed worker. We do have job data that's good up until 2015 for the community of Leamington. So basically we took that average, multiplied it by the number of employed people in our community to create an estimation of GDP at the local level. And that's that number that you see there at 2015, so $1.15 billion for GDP at the local community level for 2015. And then we use those growth figures to estimate out the GDP for 1 year, 3 year, and 5 years. And then we did a simple regression to turn that back into local jobs. And essentially what that looks like at the 1 year, 3 year, and 5 year levels is a fairly significant increase in employment within the community from the demand side, almost 800 jobs between now and 2020. And so that's fairly significant. Essentially that if this forecast holds true, what we will see then is a spin-off of about $70 million in terms of economic growth in the community from those 800 jobs. So, let me just catch up with myself here. Some of the key findings then. There's been a number of recent announcements from the time we were putting this data together till the time that this report's actually been released of some new jobs generated in the community. For example, the announcement with Lakeside. There's been a number of other ones that I've shared, the Economic Development Office has shared with us. So I think we're seeing that some of that forecasted growth is already starting to happen. Those numbers, that I think it was 388 jobs, were not included in my calculation. So those are in addition to what I'm forecasting through our research work. What we definitely are seeing is those five key sectors, which employ about 53% of the workforce locally, are going to continue to be the areas where we're going to see significant growth. And that is, of course, just to remind you again, agribusiness, manufacturing, healthcare, tourism, and what we call small business entrepreneurship. So those five areas we're going to continue. That's where we're going to see most of that growth occurring. We're already starting to see some hard-to-fill positions within those five sectors where they're having difficulty. Employers are not able to find people with the right skill set in the local labor pool, and that's an issue. And what we're going to see is that that's going to, because there's going to be growth in those occupations and continued demand there, this is going to become more of an issue. And as we move forward with this projected market demand, what we're going to see actually is a tightening of the labor pool supply. And we may not be able to effectively meet the demand that all of our local employers have for labor with the right skill set. There's a couple things that are contributing to that. One, we talked already earlier when we were here and in the very first report we did that analyzed the demographics, that we have had relatively slow growth in population in this area. And so that's contributing to that tightening of the labor supply. We talked also at that point about the demographic composition of our workforce, that we have a higher than average percentage of people aged 55 and over and age 65 and over. And we also have lower post-secondary completions than some other communities than the average in Ontario and the average nationally. Both of those things are contributing to that tightness in the labor supply in terms of not just having people, but having people with the right skill sets. Another factor that's come into play, we've seen a fairly significant reduction in the number of temporary foreign worker visas, and that has been a key recruitment tool for many of the agribusiness employers in the community. That has been a way that they have filled a number of entry-level positions. There was a fairly significant drop, and I don't have the data in front of me. I think it was from 44,000 down to about, it was almost half. between the end of 2014 and the end of 2015, the number of temporary work permits that were issued. And so that, I mean, that, and that's a national number. So certainly we can see that that's, if they've been cut in half nationally, that's going to have an impact here locally. And then the last thing, as I said already, we're forecasting an increase in demand on the labor force side. So, in terms of looking at what else we learned out of the research project and all of the different things that we've done, certainly there was some great benefit that came from the community collaboration, bringing people together in the focus groups. Employers found a lot of value in that, in having an opportunity to have some exchange with people who work in the same sector. And so you'll see that when we get to one of our recommendations, there's an initiative to kind of continue to move that forward. We did identify some very specific training gaps. I'm going to call it one at the entry level, one at the mid-level, and one at what I would call more advanced career level. Customer service skills was the one that was identified as the entry-level challenge, and that affects both small business sector, certainly in the tourism sector, that's a key component, and occasionally in some of the agribusiness sectors. The mid-level skill gap that was noted was some very specific post-secondary requirements in particularly manufacturing, agribusiness, and healthcare, where maybe we're not, employees are not keeping up with changes in technology, or we just don't have the right skill set in the community. A couple of the things that were noted there, sales and marketing, specifically in the food industry. So for the agribusiness to be able to market their products effectively, they don't have people with the right skill set. Some gaps in business planning there were noted. Logistics was a big challenge. Some of the technology around packaging innovation, we're not finding people with the right skills there. And growers, certainly in the agribusiness sector, in the greenhouse sector. In manufacturing, some of the skills around robotics and even basic machining and welding skills, having difficulty finding people with the right skill sets or at least attracting them to stay with employers in this community. And then at the more senior level, identifying a gap in leadership training. And so that's something that you'll see again is being addressed in our recommendations. What we hope we did in terms of the study that we've done was that we saw a fairly nice alignment with what the municipality of Leamington is working on and some of the plans that you have. And I know I had the privilege of hearing the mayor speak at the breakfast in Colasanti's. I was trying to remember where we were, the breakfast at Colasanti's. And so talking a lot about all the great initiatives that are already happening at the community level. So certainly there's already some things going on with workforce development. The chamber likes to think that it's a key partner with the community and with the municipality in that. And the fact that we were able to get such a great cross-section of stakeholders involved really speaks to that community development piece. And then certainly in terms of economic development, we're hoping that some of the findings in the study and some of the data analysis that we've done will be useful in terms of economic development and skill development going forward, and hopefully having an impact in terms of that improved labor market access. We know we need a little bit of work for our employers in terms of helping them figure out a little bit on the recruitment side, but probably more importantly, as that labor supply becomes tighter over the next 5 years, how to better retain existing employees, and that may mean making some adjustments to compensation and benefits, the way they're currently being delivered, as well as some things around employee engagement. So employers are going to be able to keep their good people that they have, and that we don't end up, I know in the tool and mold sector in Windsor, they got into a real challenge with people pickpocketing one employer to another, and we don't want to see that happening in our own community where we're not able to meet those needs on the labor supply side, so employers start pickpocketing from each other, because that doesn't benefit the community as a whole. So, some of our recommendations moving forward, and most of the recommendations that we're making are really related to initiatives that we hope the Chamber is going to be able to take the lead on. However, we're obviously cognizant that we can't do these things without the support of the municipality. You will see at the very end there were a couple of recommendations that really weren't 100% workforce development related, but they came out of the research work. They were aimed more at advice and whatnot for the municipal government, so we'll share them with you and you can take them under advisement. So certainly the first thing we looked at is trying to create some sort of a locally based customer service training program, and that is an initiative that the Chamber is going to be working on, trying to figure out how we can do that to meet the needs, particularly of the said small business retail and the tourism sector. We want to create some sort of a labor force working group because we see that there was tremendous benefit to employers from coming together, and one of the gaps that was identified is there is a lot of great services out there. Employment Ontario is delivering services to employees and services to employers, but job seekers and employers aren't always sure where to go to get that information. So having some sort of a working group that whose main role was really information sharing and collaborating. So having the Economic Development Office involved, having Workforce Windsor Essex involved, and they've actually already agreed to co-chair that with the Chamber, and then bringing employers and some of our service providers together. So there's some good programs available from the government to help our employers in that they don't know about them, so they're not accessing them. So again, it would be an opportunity to just keep the conversation going, keep employers engaged, and make sure we're sharing information in an effective way. One of our recommendations is to conduct a feasibility study. We think that there's an opportunity for a greenhouse center of excellence in this community, which would be basically recognizing the value that the greenhouse sector brings to this community, but more importantly, providing a training facility so that they would be able to essentially, no pun intended, grow their own employees in some of those key areas where they need. So getting post-secondary educators involved, probably University of Guelph, Ridgetown Campus, St. Clair College, maybe Lambton College, University of Windsor, depending on the particular needs of that sector. Obviously, that's a huge project and very long-term in focus, so what we'd be looking at trying to do as the Chamber is maybe working in conjunction, obviously, with the municipality, is get some funding to do the feasibility study on that, to get the right players to the table, to find out how we could structure it to make it work, how could it be sustainable going forward. We think there's a great need for some, when I say community-based, I mean geographically located, something that's accessible here in Leamington in terms of some leadership training. And that could be a private enterprise that comes in and does that locally, or it could be something that we put together with maybe sector-based, so each of the sectors develops its own in-house leadership training and figures out a way to cost-share that amongst the employers in that sector. But there is definitely a need for some leadership training. If we want to continue to see this kind of economic growth, you need to have the right leadership skills in place within those organizations to support that. We mentioned already employer recruitment and retention support. I'm thinking perhaps that working group could be the format or the forum that gets that information out to employers, you know, looking at best practices, sharing that information, again, looking at support that's available and providing that information to our employers in a way that makes it more user-friendly for them. Support and development for entrepreneurship as well. We see that small business has been definitely been the driver of growth in this local economy, and whatever we can do that would support that. So I understand there's some initiatives already underway that the municipality is working on, so the Chamber is just looking for whatever opportunity we can provide to be involved in that and to help make sure that that moves forward. One of the issues that came up, it's not directly a workforce development issue, but because of the concern around the tightening of the supply side of labor, the question of whether or not there may be some opportunity for regional transport to get workers who are, for example, unemployed in the Windsor area out to fill some potential positions in some of our employers in the Leamington area. So I do have some information. I did not end up appending it. I was debating about it, but it was kind of long. There's a great rural regional transportation study that was done in 2014, and I have their results. So I'm going to share that information with your economic development officer, and I'll allow her to sift through it and share it on with you. I said I didn't want to make this report so long that nobody actually read it. Some of you may have only read the executive summary, and I'm okay with that. So. But I think there is this could be a way to help ease some of the tightening that we are going to see in the labor force supply. And the other opportunity, certainly, that goes hand in hand with that is there an opportunity to take some of those people who are currently being drawn? It's mostly newcomers, so it could be the recent influx of Syrian refugees. It could be just immigrants as they're coming to. They tend to be drawn to the larger urban centers, the largest urban centers in an area, because there seems to be more supports and things available, and sometimes just because that's where the person ahead of them went. So is there an opportunity for Leamington to do something to position itself as a welcoming community and put some supports in place to maybe attract some of those people here? We certainly have all of the right pieces of the puzzle in place. We have effective low-cost housing available in our community. We do have a number of good supports through the municipal government. Are we taking full advantage of that? So that's just something that we might want to be thinking of, and that kind of dovetails into the last one, which again was not really asked for in the focus group work as I was doing it, but kind of came at us anyway, so we took the data and I'll share it back with you. There is a little bit of question about what is the role of the municipality in terms of economic development. One of the questions that came up was, is there a role for the staff here to be able to say, before they issue a business license, for example, do we really need this particular business in our community? So, again, I'm just going to pass this feedback on to you. You can do with it as you see fit. The other piece tied into the community development that we've just talked about, how can we position the community more effectively to attract population growth, not just at retirees, which we've done fairly successfully over the past number of years, but they're not going to contribute to that working labor force that we need. So how do we attract younger people, families, et cetera, to the community? And then the last piece in terms of workforce development, what role can the municipality play in supporting employers in terms of skills development and skills upgrading? And so I think some of that, if we had members of the municipality sitting in on this working force or labor force working group, could be a great opportunity to make sure that the right information is getting to the right people, both from the employer side and from the municipality side. So that's basically the summary. Those of you who are looking for something to put you to sleep tonight can read the whole report at your leisure. Otherwise, I'm happy to take any questions that you might have. And okay. If not, thank you for your attention.
All right. Thank you very much, Council. Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. Great report, obviously. I mean, you've gone to an awful lot of work. I just wonder what the five sectors in the workforce are that contribute to over 50% of the jobs. What are the five, without going through the whole document?
That is our agribusiness sector, manufacturing, healthcare, tourism, and small business. So the ones that the municipality has already identified as the five key sectors that it's focusing on, those are the five key ones that contribute 53%.
Okay. Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Your Worship.
Yes, Denise, thank you very much. Fantastic job, by the way, tonight singing our national anthem. Best one I've ever heard in these chambers. What are your recommendations here? Number three is kind of one that really grabbed my attention here. Conduct a feasibility study to create a greenhouse center of excellence training facility. I just want to know, how many local farm owners did you reach out to, and what was their reaction to this? My second question after that would be, who do you see taking the lead on this feasibility study? Would it be the municipality, or would it be someone like the chamber?
Well, I think a couple of things. We probably got to, in terms of key people involved in either the greenhouse sector, the food processing sector, or some form of agribusiness, growers, etc., probably of the 65 people that we spoke to, I'm going to say they were somewhere between a quarter to a third, because obviously that's a pretty significant sector in our economy. I actually have somebody who has volunteered a piece of property, and someone else who's volunteered to put up a building to put this training facility together. It was very preliminary, but when somebody says, here, I'll put a $5 million piece of property, it's like, okay, I'm interested. I don't think it matters who takes the lead. I think as long as someone takes the lead, I don't think it matters whether it's the chamber, whether it's the municipality, whether it's a working group from the sector. I don't think that makes a difference. It may make a difference if there's employer involvement in terms of getting funding from different levels of government. Generally speaking, when you can show a strong partnership, when you can show employer involvement, you're far more likely to get funding. So I think that that would be a key component. I have a great example from one of our local greenhouse sectors who had a colleague in the States who has essentially done this in one of the US states. So we have that as a preliminary structure we could look at to maybe model what we would do. And then certainly I know that your economic development officer has already had some preliminary discussions with some of the post-secondary educators to get a gauge for their level of interest. So there's already some discussions happening. I think the reason the feasibility study is important is because if you're talking about a project that I'm going to say, let's guess it's going to be $30 million to put a center like that together. Obviously, the municipality doesn't have $30 million sitting in their budget just waiting to do this. So it's going to need a great collaboration of the employer base. It's going to need some government funding. So I think the part of the reason you do a feasibility study is to get all those players to the table, get some commitment from them, and get the buy-in up front so that when you go forward to get that funding, you've got a great model and a sound base already in place so that you're far more likely to get funded to put a project like that together.
Councillor Berbicki.
Thank you, Worthy Mayor. It was a great report, and I'm so happy that the municipality's role, that we may be starting to issue some business license now in this town, which we know what's going to go into these stores, so I'm looking forward to that. My one couple questions are on there. Now, when you say there's going to be half temporary foreign workers, now are you talking temporary foreign workers or foreign agricultural workers or seasonal agricultural workers? There's three categories.
Yes. So this, I'm speaking of the temporary foreign worker visa, which is normally issued for a 2 to 3 year period and then is sometimes renewable. So if you look at that chart, I don't know what page it's on because I don't have the full report in front of me. But if you look at that chart, you'll see that there was a significant drop in the number of visas that were issued at the end of 2014 and again at the end of 2015. And so that's essentially what I'm talking about. So not talking about the seasonal workers that are coming in, because that's done under a different category. This was strictly those. So these are people that generally come and stay in the community for a period of 2 to 3 years. Oftentimes you will see those people become attached to the community, and they very often are interested in immigrating here. So they are a potential source of future population growth, because they have usually then a successful job, a successful connection into the community. So these are the longer term people that we're talking about.
And you're I want to quote a couple things on page 13.
Okay.
I guess the first one is that you're telling me that temporary foreign workers get paid less than minimum wage?
No.
Because you say the average income for a local agriculture worker reflects some lower wages paid to temporary foreign workers.
So in general, the agricultural, some of those jobs, so not specifically all of the ones in our community, but some of those positions are not paid less than minimum wage, but paid less than the average wage in the sector.
Okay.
And lower levels of I think I was referring back to that living wage.
Okay.
So lower levels than that living wage. So I don't know how familiar you are with the living wage concept, but essentially that's trying to move employers to a slightly higher level of compensation, because what they found is if you've got people at a level where they have a sufficient enough income that they can cover their basic expenses, live, et cetera, and the living wage is different community to community because it's based on your cost of living. What they found is there is some benefit to the employer in terms of improved employee engagement, better retention. So it may be a strategy. So that's what I was talking about. I was comparing it to that living wage, not to minimum wage.
Okay, and then on the chart on page 13, I always like charts. It has the whole gamut there of the employment by industry. But reading this, it's low, and it looks like there's 1,800 people involved in the agricultural workforce. Now, we know that's not correct, right?
Sorry, just one second. I need to get the chart out. You have a copy of that? I didn't bring my own copy, sorry.
Page 13.
Sorry. Okay.
been good for TV, eh?
Okay. Yeah, the problem camera's probably on you right now, too. The chart on the left-hand side.
So that those numbers should be totaling up, essentially, this is based on 2015 jobs, that should be totaling up to the 12,254, which is the number of employed people in the community. So that may not be the total amount of numbers. The other thing is you've got some distribution here between agricultural forestry and manufacturing, which covers some of our agribusiness processing. So they're split really between those two categories in terms of the total numbers. Okay?
That's fair. Thanks. Thanks a lot. Great report.
All right. Thank you.
Deputy Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Denise, I think I told you last time that I was really impressed because I hadn't expected, how should I put it? I'd expected one of those things that you put on the shelf and it gathers dust and that would be it, but this is obviously not that.
Thank you.
I had a couple of questions. I was quite impressed with your Greenhouse Center of Excellence. A number of years ago, a few key people got together at our old town hall and we tried to bring the key people together and it never went anywhere. We had the gentleman that would donate the building and we had the college and I think we needed the feasibility study and a bag of money. So I'm glad to see the feasibility study because the bag of money is still not going to be there.
Okay.
I'm also happy with your working group because that keeps all the people engaged and that keeps it a living document by having the...
That was my hope.
...the working group. And the support and development for entrepreneurship, I like that too because a few years ago, I'm going to say close to 20, there was an organization and I can't recall what they were called, but it was a small office and they would help people who were interested in going into business. And I took advantage of that. It was free, but they were professional people with the skills and the background to help you do your market study and do all your homework, and then the money ran out and that office closed. And it was key for me and it was key for a lot of other folks as well. So definitely something that needs to be carried on.
So if I might add there are some folks out of the Windsor-Essex Economic Development Commission that work in that small business area. And I was just at a meeting last week at Cardinal Carter High School. And they're putting together an awesome program where they're going to be introducing entrepreneurship skills to a pilot group of students. They're going to bring them around. 5 weeks, one each week, they're going to feature one of the key sectors, starting with agribusiness, manufacturing, healthcare, all of the five sectors that we've identified. And that would be, again, thanks to your economic development officer, who was also at that meeting. And they're going to tour them through a facility on one day, and the other day they're going to have other employers from that sector come in and talk about how you start a business in that sector, as well as what are some of the other key careers, if you're not interested in being a business owner, what are some of the other key careers that you could aspire to. So it's going to hopefully do two things. It's going to help to fill some of that gap on the post-secondary side by maybe getting some students excited about, hey, I could be a grower in a greenhouse, or hey, I could be a logistics manager in a food processing plant. So some of those kinds of ideas. And then certainly they're actually going to have an entrepreneurship conference, a one-day conference, to really promote that idea. And the folks from WEEDC are interested in coming out into this community and doing more work with folks here in Leamington to really help foster that small business.
Well, I think that's key, to have something local, because our people are hesitant to go to the city.
I think that's part of the problem with some of the issues we've identified, is that there's services available, but they're in Windsor or they're in London or they're not here. Mm-hmm. And that dissuades people from using them if they're not here.
It does. Now, that leads me to the regional transportation. How in-depth did you get? Did you get to... No? Okay.
No. So I think what we heard, this is, part of the process, I think, when we ran through that at the very beginning, we did something called a validation workshop. So after we had done all of the data gathering at the beginning of the process, we came back to those folks at the end, showed them the economic forecast model, and asked for their feedback on whether the model made any sense to them, and then talked about some of the recommendations that had come out of the various data analysis and the work that we'd done, and essentially asked them to do two things. One, to make sure that we hadn't missed anything as far as recommendations go, and then to prioritize those recommendations. So the regional transport issue came out a little bit in some of the qualitative work, and then was really reinforced as a key concept in that validation workshop. So that only happened at the end of March. So I have not had a lot of opportunity, and nor did I have the mandate to go ahead and do a lot of work on that. So I was able to locate, as I said, one good study that showed the process that this other rural community used, and that maybe will be useful to kind of get some preliminary discussions happening here. There is, I'm aware of, two groups that are trying to do something. One's a not-for-profit that's trying to establish, basically they're buying an old school bus and trying to see what they can do around just a once-a-day run that would kind of line up with local employers' day shifts. I don't know, again, they're working on putting the model together and getting some funding on that, but because they're trying to do it as a not-for-profit, they may have some success because their obviously costs are relatively low and they're not looking to do it as a money-making venture. And then there's a second group, and that's Workforce Windsor Essex, is looking at some of those issues, and they are starting to do some analysis and study on that, so I'm hoping there'll be something coming out of their work fairly soon that might give a bit more meat to how do we actually make this work in Essex County. But yes, that was not really my purview other than to just say this came up as a recommendation from local business people and the community members that we
talked. Cost and the fact of...
Yeah. And again, there may be an opportunity for employers, if they are perceptive and they see where the trend is heading, to say it might behoove us to spend some money to be part of this if it's a way to ensure that we get a steady supply of potential employees to our front door. Yeah. So, I mean, again, that might be part of the opportunity.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Your Worship. Great report. My focus really is on this, is the labour aspect of it. And we know for a fact that we have low-skilled labour in our particular area. And I was curious, have you identified where we are really lacking and what type of skilled labor? Like, are we looking for computer analysts? Are we looking for welders? Where are we really lacking, and what will it take for us to attract those individuals so that we can attract industry, or industry can attract them?
So if you read through the section on page 15 that talks about the skills gaps, that's really the areas where it was most prevalent. So we talk about three different types of skills. We talk about job skills, we talk about essential skills, and we talk about soft skills or workplace soft skills. So job skills are more technically related. Where we saw some of those gaps in manufacturing, they are having difficulty getting machinists, welders, and people with robotics. So those are some very technical job-related skills. Essential skills are more of those things that are like oral communication, document use, numeracy, some very basic skills that you need to have to be in the workplace. Where we saw a bit of gap there is occasionally in the greenhouse and food processing sector. Sometimes people did not have the basic literacy, numeracy skills to be able to do the work, or there was a lot of assistance required on the part of the employer to make them effective in the workplace. In terms of other soft skills, customer service, we identified leadership and supervisory skills, we identified as where there was a skills gap. And as far as other technical skills, some of those ones I mentioned in the greenhouse sector, logistics, sales and marketing, business planning, those are definitely a gap where there's, and growers, so where there's a very specific post-secondary education requirement. But we're not finding people with those skill sets in the community. So that was a lot. Those ones identified in the agricultural and agri-processing sector was a lot of what was driving the idea of this center of excellence for the greenhouse, so that they would literally be able to train their own people to fill the roles and the needs as they had them occurring within their sector. So those are the most prevalent. There's also a little bit of a gap in healthcare, sometimes finding people, again, that's certain post-secondary skills or people who are in the field and have the basic post-secondary education but may not have the most up-to-date technology, where things are changing fairly quickly in that sector and there's lots of new technology coming into healthcare. We're finding a bit of a gap there. So nurses are qualified, but they were trained 20 years ago. They may not have the most, not be up to date on the most current technologies that could be used in their field, as an example.
Okay, with the exception of currently of our agricultural industry here, I guess I'm focusing more outside of the agricultural industry, like to the other manufacturers and processors that we do have. How difficult is it for them currently, and are they able to get sufficient individuals in that meet the criteria that they require?
Yes and no. So they are, at the current moment, managing. They're not managing without some difficulty, but they are managing to find mostly enough people to fill most of the roles they have. So not all, there are some gaps, as I said, individual folks have mentioned, but mostly at this time. So what I see coming is a further tightening of that, as for all the reasons that I indicated, challenges around, you know, demand outstripping the labor supply, the tightening on the temporary foreign visa, because that is a key source of recruitment for a lot of those local employers, the slowing of population growth here, all the aging workforce. I mean, all of those factors are coming together to put that additional pressure on the labor force supply side, and demand is continuing to grow. So we're just barely meeting it now. So over the next 5 years, I'm foreseeing that we're going to have some difficulty. And I mean, if you look at that, the little economic model that we've put together, I mean, you can't hang your hat 100% on those numbers, because obviously we don't have the high quality GDP number at a local level, et cetera, et cetera. For all the, you know, you read the limitations section, I mean, that's, there's a reason that's in there. So I don't guarantee you that that 791 job growth I've projected is 100% accurate, but what I do feel confident in telling you is that's the direction that the community is moving in terms of the demand side, and the tightening is definitely the direction that the community is going to see in terms of the supply side, and that's going to create a challenge for employers over the next 5 years. So we need to do something now to address that issue so that we don't hamper the continued potential growth of our employers.
Okay, so I'll let you know that this is the kind of report that keeps me awake at night. It doesn't put me to sleep, because I get into that kind of stuff reading the analysis. So thank you for doing that work. And as you've mentioned a couple of times throughout your talks tonight, either answering questions or your presentation, you've acknowledged that you're aware that the municipality has already been working or is working on some of these recommendations, if not all of them. Actually, I marked down many of these recommendations are what we have already been talking about, the Deputy Mayor and CAO and our EDO and myself and members of councils at times. So the way I see this is a really nice addition to the team, bringing some meat and potatoes to the table for us to use, as the Deputy Mayor has said, that we can now take to, as a group, to those interested parties and to our upper levels of government and see if we can't pull this all together and make it happen. So I thank you for doing that report in the chamber, for taking the lead on getting this done. And I look forward to us working on, as a team, to make this stuff happen. So
thank you so much. Yeah. One thing I did forget to say, which was just a quick thank you to the people who served as our steering committee. So obviously, Wendy as the chamber manager. We did have Janine Lasseline-Berglund from the municipality on our steering committee. Dave Campbell, Wayne Warham, and Dave Dick from DVD Farms. So we had a great team of people that really know this community and brought a lot to the table and helped to make sure that our work as a the team that I brought to work with me, that we stayed focused, and we hope presented you some useful information that you exactly can use going forward to achieve some great things for Leamington.
Yeah. Well, it'll be interesting to see what feedback you get with the people you're sharing this with tomorrow. So
absolutely.
Cool. Very good. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Worship.
Right. The next item on the agenda is one regarding the Leamington Triathlon Weekend. Ms. Abbs is starting us off.
Yes, thank you, Mayor and members of council. The report before you is to provide you with an update on the Triathlon Weekend, which is going to be held this year on June 11th and the 12th. And we're requesting council to accept the funding commitments by the group for projects that are set out in the future at the Leamington Kinsman Recreation Complex. So just to give you a little bit of background, the municipality received a request from the race directors of the triathlon for permission to stage the annual weekend. There's a variety of different locations throughout the 2 days. The Saturday is held at the complex indoors and in our parking lot. And then the Sunday event is held at the waterfront promenade in the municipal marina. There's a variety of different distances and level of competition, and this is a race that does generate a lot of visitors to our area. The organizing committee is requesting some in-kind contributions from the municipality to use the pool, fencing, and some barricades, which is something that we have normally done in the past. In turn, the race director has committed to donate some funds in the past for the 2015-2016. Money was used to purchase the cadence meters on the spin bikes that are located in the spin studio. There isn't any specific commitments for the 2017 and 2018 donation. They were going to wait to see how the race events turned out. So they are going to commit to providing us with the necessary certificate of insurance, and there's approximately $5,000 over the next 2 years that may be contributed toward the complex. So the resolution is quite detailed, as you can see in the report, but essentially it's asking for permission to use the event to be exempt from the fees and tariffs bylaw with respect to fees, and that they would finish purchasing off that cadence meter for this year. There was $3,300 approximately left for them from their commitment, and that the commitment for the 2017 and 2018 be received as part of our letter of acceptance. And Mr. Campbell is here to help answer any particular questions that council may have.
Okay, thank you very much. Does Council Wilkinson?
Thank you, Your Worship. Come on down, Dave. Dave, just wondering, I see here it's a responsibility of the organizing committee to notify the business entities that are affected by these closures. Is there any sort of effort put towards notifying the residents, homeowners that are affected by this as well? Because I think each year you probably receive a number of complaints, I'm sure. I'm just wondering if we can get out ahead of that, maybe notify
them. Yeah, well, last year we took high school kids needed some credit hours, so we took them out. And actually, the major problem we have, I hate to say it, no golfers here, is people who are late for the tee-off times. I go to the pro shop, they post a letter 3 weeks in advance, we call all the businesses, we put it in the paper, and we try to get a letter to everybody that we can possibly think of. Actually, the residents have probably been the best, but we try to get out as much as we can.
Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. Dave, it's always exciting when you can bring people to town, and first of all, I want to congratulate you. I understand you had over 500 participants on the weekend in your marathon.
Just 10 short of 500 yesterday.
10 short of 500, that's great. And with that, as I said, I think it's great for the community when you can bring this many people in, and especially lodging and food and all those other things that go along with that. So I'll move for the acceptance of the report.
Okay, motion on the floor. Support by Councillor Wilkinson. Further discussion? I do. I've got comments. Actually, it's more tongue-in-cheek than anything. I like the economic analysis that's here. It's extremely realistic. Now, if we were like somebody else in the area that uses the sports tourism economic model, you guys would be projecting millions of dollars being spent.
I'm surprised
here.
We aren't, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, I'm almost recommending it for the next time. But seriously, I like seeing the real dollars that we know are going to be spent here, and not all the trickle down offshoot stuff that builds these things up to unrealistic expectations. So,
like even yesterday, we realized we didn't have to come to council for report, but we realized what we're doing. So we hope to. Are very minor. We give diabetes $5,000. We're really happy. So,
yep.
And spend a lot of food. A lot of people ate a lot of food in yesterday in Leamington.
Yep, that was a good. It was a good day for that too. Yep, Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Dave. Just out of curiosity, I know that we've had a couple of the participants in that Ironman thing
go
on to bigger and better things.
Yes.
Do you have any idea how many we've had altogether? I know that they come from all over.
For Lionel Sanders, for example, if you follow anything, he was from Harrow. He started out at our events. In the last, I think, where's my Ironman expert? I think in the last 4 weeks, he's won he's won at least 3 or 4 half Ironmans in the world, California, Texas, and Florida. He just actually didn't come close. He won them all. Yeah. We have another lady who is just a 42-year-old lady who loves to run, who went to Chicago with us last year and won a gold medal and beat everybody in her age group by 3 minutes, and only a 25-year-old and a 30-year-old in the whole world beat her. She's from Leamington. I don't know why we had 8 top 20s in the world last year in Leamington at the World Championships. We don't know why. We work together. We have a couple of clubs, as you know. We have one of your astound administration on our Tri-West Club who races and travels all over the town, all over the world, and shows off Leamington. We just love to race, and for some reason, we get a lot of people to do it.
Must be that something in the tomatoes.
It must be. It depends on which ketchup you eat that day.
Yeah. I just want to say, great job, Dave. I know that you put a lot of time and effort into all this stuff, and
thanks.
Real
pat on the back. I have fun doing it.
You must.
All right. If there are no further questions, we have the recommendation on the floor. All those in favor? And carried. So, while you're sitting there, we'll move on to the next one. Ken, you're going to take us through this one. It's the report regarding temporary road closure, Ride for Dad.
Yes, thank you, and good evening, Mayor and members of Council. This report is to request Council's approval for a temporary road closure and in-kind support for a Ride for Dad event on Sunday, May 29th from 11 to 4. And as this is the annual Ride for Dad motorcycle tour through Windsor and Essex County, and it's an event to raise awareness and support for the fight against prostate cancer. Organizers would like to make Freddy's Restaurant an official stop for this year's ride. They're expecting about 1,200 riders and have therefore requested the temporary closure of a portion of Mercer Road C, and you can see in the report which section. It's basically just south of Mercia Park. And they've also just in-kind contribution to set up the closure. Administration does not have any objections to the requested road closure and recommends that the request be granted under the terms and condition as detailed in the report. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Council. Moved by Councillor Jacobs. John, I'm sorry. You say move? You
yes,
moved it?
Yes.
Okay. Moved by Councillor Jacobs. Support by Councillor Wilkinson. Questions? Councillor Berbicki?
Really, Mayor, thanks. I just hope that the residents know about this, and especially the trailer park, because there's not going to be some angry trailer people.
Trailer park was the first person we talked to. He's one of our triathletes. He was the first one we talked to. The road closing will not go to his entrance. The actual placement at the end of the fence where we will close off the road covers about 3 houses who have also been notified, and we will leave an entrance. We will leave, theoretically, we've already talked, we can move 2 barricades and get a fire truck through. We just want to, when the 1,200 guys bring their bikes down, we'd just like to have a little bit of spot for them.
Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, again, thank you. Dave, as I read through this the other day, I was curious. Are you going to 1,200 people, and I know you want to stop at Freddy's, are you going to set up a tent in the park, or is that the plan?
Yeah, I'm sort of the mouthpiece. You find it hard to believe they needed somebody to talk, so they sent me, because Mike's actually run the restaurant. We have a tent, we have portable washrooms, we're getting an extension of the liquor license, we're going through the health unit, getting the Porta Johns in, going through all the steps. When you say 1,200, what happens is when you ride, for the ride starts in Windsor, and as you get farther along, it splits up into groups and it'll start. So it won't be 1,200 at one time. That's why we have 11 to 4. You might get 100 bikes rolled in, you might get 200 bikes rolled in. And Hogs for Hospice, I lost track. Hogs for Hospice is going to work with us. They're going to be passing out pamphlets. They're going to be parking the bikes. They're going to have I guess you might call it a trial run of what happens when 1,000 bikes come into town. So Don, I've already talked to Donnie, and they're going to come down and work with us to see what it's like, to give them a head start.
Okay. So it's been regularly moved and seconded. All those in favor of the recommendation and carried.
Thank you. Sure. And by the way, thank you for being so nice to Miss Gannon. She's been a great addition. And when we went to Highway, she spoke about 2 minutes, and we said, okay, we know who's going to do the report. So thank you for being so nice to her.
Next item on the agenda is a report regarding the Windsor Catholic School Board regarding Cardinal Carter and Soccer and Hockey Skills Academy. Ms. Abbs?
Thank you again, Mayor and members of Council. I'd like to provide you with some information regarding a proposed Soccer and Hockey Skills Academy that is being proposed by the Windsor Essex Catholic District School Board to be in partnership with Cardinal Carter School and the Leamington Kinsman Recreation Complex. Just to give you a little bit of background, administration was approached by the school board to provide space, and the space is for grades 7 to 12. These will be the new students at the new school this fall. The academy itself offers students in both the secondary and the elementary levels either a soccer or a hockey program. It's an opportunity to have the children at different skill levels have time doing something that they love to do, and the teachers will actually come to the complex to provide them with their morning classes, and then there's land opportunities, and then another teacher would come at after that to do the additional classes, and then in the lunchtime they move back to their main campus, which will be Cardinal Carter. So the proposal is to start this in the fall. This is a really great opportunity for the complex, as the academy rentals will be held during non-peak times. The Highbury Canco Arena auditoriums A and B and the Highbury Canco meeting room will be the areas where we'll accommodate the space for the students. So should council support the program, administration would then undertake further negotiations with the school board to break out pricing and anything extra that they might need, like Wi-Fi, printer and fax machine accessibility, use of the customer service reps, and so on. So the recommendation this evening is that council supports the proposed hockey and soccer skills academy for the complex, and that the CAO and the director be authorized to negotiate with the school board to accommodate for the academy at the complex, and the administration report back to council with the final approved agreement for execution.
Thank you very much. Questions or comments from council? Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Worship. Tracy, when you bring back the final report, that gives us the opportunity at that time to tweak whatever we feel would be appropriate for the municipality. This is just receiving this, correct, tonight?
Yes, receiving this and giving us authorization to enter into those negotiations. One of the challenges is that we don't specifically have a fee schedule for this type of use. It's a rental agreement, essentially, or a user agreement, sorry, that we would want to just break down exactly how many hours we would allow them to use the facilities, and then we would decide on a new cost that would be outside of the fees bylaw.
Okay, I appreciate that. I'll move the report.
Okay. Motion supported by Councillor Hammond. Councillor Verbeke.
I just was happy to see that any income coming into the complex, you know, it's a no-brainer. It's a great, great opportunity.
Okay. Further questions, comments? Deputy Mayor?
And it's also building our clientele. If we get them to come in now, then down the road, perhaps they'll sign up for other things. So, yeah, I think what you said, Mr. Verbeke, no-brainer on this. We need to go out and see how it works. So I think it's great.
Okay. All those in favor of the motion, and carried. Next item on the agenda is a report regarding the purchase of diesel cab and chassis. And Mr. Brown?
Thank you, Mayor and members of council. So this report is on the results of tenders received for a diesel cabin chassis and to request council authorization to award the tender to the lowest bidder. Two tenders were received, and Team Truck Centers being the lowest bid at a little over $130,000. The vehicle recommended for purchase is a replacement to the existing fleet and within the approved budget amount of $200,000. Additional costs will be incurred to purchase a box, snow plows, and salting equipment, as well as other associated attachments. The planned outfitting specification was to include a slide-in salter, which is an improved design from the traditional tailgate salter, but is also more expensive. With the possibility that the overall price may come in higher than budget, administration will include options in the outfitting tender spec for the less expensive traditional equipment as well, and then we'll report back to council once we receive. If there's any request for an over budget, then we would also identify how we're going to mitigate that. But again, we did include options in the tender spec that can hopefully allow us to pick the best package overall. The recommendation is that the purchase of this one 2016 Freightliner cabin chassis from Team Truck Centers be approved for purchase and charge to the Public Works capital account as detailed in the report. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Worship. Ken, you made mention of the salting box for that. This box would be interchangeable with, if you got another unit, you know, another 4 years or 5 years, you would be able to interchange this with that. So that would be a good move going in that direction, even though if it's a little bit more money.
Yes, most of the equipment, the add-ins that you add on to these trucks, if the truck is of a certain size, they are interchangeable. So you can take, this slide-in salter and put that into a different truck as long as it's, has the same size box, because it basically fits inside the construction box of the truck.
I think it's a good move. Thank you.
Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. A comment, and Ken, I understand the process as well as anyone. It's just troubling that, you know, that we've got to go out of town for the sake of about 2% difference. You know, it'd be nice to see that truck driving around. When you look at the rear license or the rear mud flap, it says Leamington International Trucks on it. And again, just a comment. It troubles me to think that for $3,000 out of a $130,000 unit that we have to go that far away to get it. That's
Always a conundrum. Anyway, what are council's wishes? Moved by Councillor Jacobs. Support by Councillor Wilkinson. Discussion on the motion. All in favor? And carried. Next item on the agenda is one regarding the tender award for turf maintenance. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mayor. So this report is on the result of tenders received for a turf maintenance contract at various municipal properties and to request council authorization to award the contract to the lowest bidder. So two tenders were received with K&M Yard Care being the lowest bid. K&M has held this contract to the satisfaction of administration for the past three terms, so that would be 9 years. The financial impact to the municipality would be approximately $82,000 per year, with a 3% annual price increase for years 2 and 3 of the contract. So the recommendation is that the 2016 to 2018 turf maintenance contract be awarded to K&M Yard Care. Thank you.
Questions? Councillor Verbeke? Moved. Support by Deputy Mayor. Questions? All in favor of the motion? Carried. Thank you. And final report is one regarding community CIP 150, expansion of Seacliff Park Waterfront Trail and Beachfront. Mr. Sharon.
Yes, thank you, Mayor Patterson, members of council. Council has heard of this program in the past. We were before council asking for approval to submit for this particular project, and council was notified that we were successful. However, we were recently notified by FedDev that we actually need a contribution agreement, and so in order for us to enter into that legal agreement, we need council's blessing to do that. The one thing I will point out to council that is new is we do have our concept drawing of the potential layout of where the beach volleyball courts are going to be, as well as the paths that we plan on building down to the waterfront. And they can, council can see that drawing before them. We are currently in discussions with the Conservation Authority because of the location of these works. Some of them may be located on provincial lands, and it's also in the regulated area. So we just have to be sensitive to the requirements of doing works in and around this area. And so the recommendation before council is that we enter into the agreement and that the mayor and clerk be authorized to execute those agreements.
Excellent. Questions, comments? Council's wishes? Moving and support by Councillor Hammonds. Discussion? All in favor? All in favor and carried. Thank you. Matters for approval. We have the minutes of the Mayor's Youth Advisory Committee held February 9th. Moved by Councillor Verbeke. Support by the Deputy Mayor. Any discussion on that? All in favor? And carried. Other matters. Moving right to consideration of bylaws. Ms. Percy.
Bylaw 2716 being a bylaw to confirm the proceedings of Council from its meeting held April 18th, 2016.
Looking for mover and seconder. Councillor Wilkinson. Support by Deputy Mayor. Discussion on the motion. All in favor? Carried. There were no notice of motion circulated, so we're into open session for council and staff. Councillor Jacobs.
Thank you, Worship. I have a couple of things. One, bike racks. When will they be installed? I was seeing the weekend that we have a tremendous amount of bike activity in the downtown core again. I just see Ken already left, but I presume they'll be going in shortly, Rob.
You're not.
I would anticipate Ken and his group has that built into their schedule. Councillor, I can get you a date as early as tomorrow. Ken's probably driving, so I shouldn't send him a note right now.
I don't need an exact date. I know they will be going in to just make sure they're going in sooner than later.
Yes, very soon. I'll make a note of that.
And the other thing that, again, Ken's not here, but Erie Street South, just past Seacliff Drive, there's some humongous potholes down there in the asphalt and so forth that I think could take some attention. And that's it for me. Thanks.
Okay. Councillor Verbeke.
Really, Mayor, I'm quite pleased to congratulate the town on getting Longfield Street finally lit up. They did have to run a whole new line, so that did take a long. So it's lit, the people are happy, and it's a good news story.
Good. Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. This is a good opportunity to remind everyone that the Leamington Chamber of Commerce, their annual golf tournament, will take place on May the 18th. If you're an early bird registry, you can be eligible for a 55-inch TV. This year, there's only 100 golfers, and I think it's filling up quick, so please sign up. You have to get a hold of Wendy at the chamber at 326-2721. And 18 holes of golf, power cart, prime rib buffet, all for $130.
Very good.
Good evening. Just to advise council and the public that the commissioners will be out canvassing door-to-door to enforce our dog registration bylaw starting tomorrow and lasting until the end of May.
Thank you, Ms. Horton. Everybody got their dog licenses? Good. Real quick for me, when we were having the presentation on those two events that we just passed tonight, I was a little tongue-in-cheek about the return on investment, but for all of council, I mean, really, you think about what we're proposing to spend on those, the in-kind costs, and you look at the amount of money that will be flowing back into this community, even without the, you know, over-extrapolation of that, it's a heck of a return, and I'm glad we are paying attention to those kind of things here in our municipality and promoting them, so good on all of you for doing that. And that's going to be it for me under open session. So if there's nothing else, oh yeah, understatement's non-debatable. Yeah, I got you. Yep, you're here for 20 more minutes. So anything else from staff at all under open session? Nope. All right. So move on to statements non-debatable. Anything from council? Statements non-debatable? No? Okay. I'm just going to tell you what happened over the weekend. Is April 17th, Sunday morning, bright and early, a group of six of us, and along with 490 other people, I think he said they were 10 short of 500, did the walk and the run, just walk for me, but a 5K walk, and then they had the different runs for the little kids and the people who are actually athletes. It was a great, great turnout down at Point Pelee National Park, so congratulations to Mike McClough. And it's just a fundraiser for juvenile diabetes, and it was really great, really well run. Wednesday, April 13th, I was invited, along with Mayor Nelson Santos, to attend the Leamington Hospital Foundation Volunteers Luncheon, and another great group of people that were there. And so we were able to bring greetings from our various municipalities, and I know their day went on further than that. We didn't stick around for the whole thing, but a great, great turnout for them. And again, just say thank you to all the volunteers for all the work that they do. So, and that's it for me. Motion to adjourn. Councillor Hammond, we don't do meetings anymore, so nope, so sorry. Moved by Councillor Hammond, supported by Councillor Wilkinson, all in favour, and carried.